Found it. I told you, Bywood. I told you. It just took me a bit. Got into the right file and found it and pulled it out the other day. To me, that, you know, that's our Friday. That's our Friday music as we open up. That's for Karen, Cam, and Cody. That's, you know, they kind of like that. So I've kind of made that the Friday music, and it's just. But I found that somebody sent it to me several years ago. And if I'm not mistaken, it was a bunch of troops are all together. I think they're either in Iraq or Afghanistan. I don't know which. Can't remember now. But it's a worship service with a bunch of soldiers, and they're singing that. And it, you know, it just does it for me. So it is. You're right. It is awesome. It is awesome. So, you know, maybe once in a while on Friday, I'll pop that one in there, because that one will really get your heart a-going and beating. And, see, a room full of soldiers singing that song with all of the movements and everything. I just, yeah. If that doesn't get you, if that doesn't get your praise or appraise, then it's broken, I think. Good morning to everybody. Good morning, good morning. Miss Carolyn, good morning. You introduced that song to the church, well, to me for sure. And, you know, I know you like that one. All of you do that seen it. So, it's great. Good morning, Miss Ruth. It's good to have you there this morning. Say hi to Ken for us, would you? Kenneth, Miss Terry, good morning to you. You got hearts out there this morning, so I'll throw you, kind of, I love you. Buddy Julia, God bless. It's good to have you there. Miss Donna, good morning. I hope you survived your little snow episode, but my dear sweet Miss Cherry is there, and there is Miss Sue. Good morning to you. Don't you just love that music video? Yes, I do. Buddy says, wow. Alicia says, thank you for the video. It's very moving. Absolutely, and good morning to you, and good morning to Kara and Cam and Cody as well. But he says, so awesome. Terry says, oh, my heart. Kara said, bring tears to my eyes and heart as I praise God. Isn't it? You know, what a way to start the morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Oh, it is so good to have you all out here this morning. That's awesome that many guys who were singing together. And, you know, it was just worship. I love it, you know. When you get to hoorah in there and everything, maybe that's what we ought to do. We ought to throw in a little hoorah on Sunday mornings when we sing that song. Wouldn't that be great? At any rate, here we go. Here we go. All right. Yeah, well, yesterday, you know, we were really centered in on looking at the picture of the Trinity, you know, in the baptism of Jesus. And in verses 9 through 11, we have this marvelous scene in Mark and chapter 1. Laura, good morning to you. I don't know whether you got in to see the soldiers doing Days of Elijah or not, but I got to play it this morning. Good morning to you, your sweet husband, by the way. My wonderful son-in-law passed his test. He's got a couple of days to do a little R&R and rest up before he starts working on the next protocols for the next jet that he'll be flying. So he's got three of them to learn, and that's what he's down there doing in the month of December in sunny Atlanta, down in Buddy and Julia's country, all right? In Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, says that it came about in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth to Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And immediately coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit as a dove descending upon him. And a voice came out of the heavens, thou art my beloved Son, in thee I am well pleased. Now, in these three verses we have pictured, do we not? We have in that tableau we have Jesus the Son coming in the fullness to fulfill the fullness of all righteousness, as he said. We have the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove coming down upon the Son, and we have the Father identifying himself and speaking from heaven. Thou art my beloved Son, in thee I am well pleased. Jesus Christ is the beloved of the Father. That word beloved is the enduring term that shows that Jesus is the object eternally of the Father's affection. He is the one in whom the Father takes great delight, and it is this one that has been sent by the Father as our Redeemer. In whom, he says, I am well pleased. You see, Isaiah makes a similar messianic declaration in Isaiah 42 and verse 1 when he says, behold, my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the nations. Now there again, do we not see the dual, two prophecies slammed into one verse? I don't know how many times I've pointed out to you that often when we're looking at a prophecy in the Old Testament, we will have combined in that one prophecy both the first advent and the second advent of Christ, because they couldn't see as they looked back over. They could just see the mountain peaks and not the valleys in between. So we see the gigantic, wonderful mountain peak of his first coming. Behold, my servant in whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. There's the first peak, coming at his baptism right there. There's another peak out here. He will bring forth justice to the nations. Well, that's going to happen, but it's still out here, future, is it not, on yet another far mountain peak. And we're in that great valley between the two peaks, looking back at the one and forward to the other. The Father finds eternal pleasure in the Son. He found pleasure in the Son's incarnation, in his sinless life, and in his faithfulness. So Jesus, or God, says to Jesus, as he's speaking to him from heaven, John overhears, he hears it. What the rest of the crowd heard or understood is still, to me, kind of an unknown. I don't want to leave anything to speculation, but I believe, just like when Saul was on the Damascus Road and God spoke to him and that blinding light knocked him off his mule and blinded him, I believe his handlers that were there with him, that got him into Damascus, they saw a bright light, they heard a noise, he probably turned away, didn't know what was happening. But the voice was specifically to Paul, speaking to Saul, as it were, at that point, right down to the very heart, to the core of what he needed. What the rest heard or saw, you know, that's a different story. But here we have the baptism of Christ, the very words of God saying, "Thou art my beloved Son, in thee I am well pleased." And we all know God is still well pleased with his Son. And if you are united with him through faith, as I know many that are out here listening this morning are, but some that I know are listening are not yet. If you have, since our last communications, you haven't let me know, made that decision to follow Christ in faith. Well, if you're united with him through faith in his Son, then you will be he will be well pleased with you also. The glory of this gospel message is that God sees all who have trusted him in Christ. And Ephesians 1:6 says, "It is to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he has freely bestowed on us in the beloved, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of our sin." Every one of us ought to say to ourselves every morning, get up, look in the mirror, and say, "This is what the Father is saying to me. I am in his Son, in his beloved, and since you are my beloved son, my beloved daughter, then he is also well pleased with you." And that's what gives us a sense of security and identity, a place to stand, which means that we can be calm and unthreatened when everything goes to pieces around us. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the joy of your word. I thank you for the joy of your living presence within the life of all who believe. I thank you, Lord, that you are not only my Lord, you are my Savior. You are indeed my brother. In fact, you are closer than a brother. You are indeed the beloved of the Father. And because we are in you, the love of the Father covers us as well. God, I pray that you will be well pleased with our study this morning, with our involvement, with the heart of worship and praise that we come to you before. And Lord, I pray with all of my heart that you will open our eyes and open our ears this morning to see and hear what it is that you're saying to us. And open our hearts to receive your word, Lord, engrafted in us, implanted in us, so that it becomes part of our bone, our marrow, the very strength of our life. Father, let us come and fill our heart full of you today. May you be blessed in these moments, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, folks, I pray you have no problem understanding me this morning. I am really stuffy, so I'm not hearing as well as I should. And, I know my voice sounds a little off, but we'll get through this. These three verses in Mark give us probably one of the strangest, most mystifying scenes in the Gospels. You have the very humble beginnings in the very name of Jesus, that common and unremarkable name in its day, is it not? In fact, in many parts of the world, it is still a very common name for people to have. But he's a very uncommon man. You have him described as Jesus from Nazareth. That Nazareth, that very small, insignificant place in the Galilean hills. It was just really a military outpost. It was just a few miles from the summer palace of Herod called Sephora, which they have been thoroughly excavating over the years. And workmen on the building and the care of that palace lived in Nazareth, this dusty little hamlet, and there was a garrison there. So it was a military town. It was a wild and raucous and rough and tough little desert town out there in the middle of the Galilean hillside out there. It was not well respected or well thought of. Remember the comment that is made when Nathanael says, "Has anything good ever come out of Nazareth?" Any rate, it is background. It's unassuming, not only a despised Galilean, but from this insignificant place with a bad reputation. Because he is Nazareth of Galilee. Now, there are other Nazareths, so to be specific, John Mark says Nazareth of Galilee, the unspiritual region, the wild west kind of region, not right there in the center of the Bible Belt, if you will, of the area of its time. It says that he was baptized. In other words, this insignificant Nazarite from Galilee, from Nazareth of Galilee, comes in and he's baptized, identifying himself with sinful men who are in need of repentance. And it says where he was baptized was in the Jordan, which again is an unremarkable, even a rather unpleasant river. Generally a slow-moving river. It's muddy, it's dirty, it's not pure, clean mountain water that comes down out of the glacier-fed hills. No, early rabbinic tradition explicitly disqualifies the River Jordan as a place where the rites of purification could be held. Then you have the great glory of the heavens literally being torn into, ripped apart, with the heavens parting. And this phrase, as I said, is strong. It's the only one of the Gospels that used the word schizo to describe what happens when the heavens were opened up. And again, I think that comes from Peter's eyewitness testimony. It's used there. It's also used at the ripping of the temple, the tearing of, or the veil, the tearing it apart. Then you have the majestic scene of the Spirit descending. Spirit of God was present, and in some way, his presence was discernible, at least not only to Jesus, but to John as well. And then, of course, you have the majestic voice of God, that booming, thunderous voice of God speaking. And I think the tone of love and proud, all of that coming from the voice of the Father. You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. What could be more glorious than to have God the Father praise and affirm you publicly as he did that day? I think the relevant point that Mark is making, as well as the other gospel writers, is that this was an event that was so spectacular, so earth-shattering, that when Jesus began his ministry and his mission, because this is the very launch of that, the heavens were literally ripped open. Just like when he finished his ministry, the veil was literally ripped open, making way into the presence of God for all who would come by faith. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, that Holy Trinity of God, were all involved in the launching of this eternally life-changing, earth-shattering mission. So, we come then to the Trinity in action. This text is one of the familiar passages in the New Testament that shows us the entire Trinity together in one picture. God the Son is baptized. God the Father affirms that and speaks from heaven. And God the Holy Spirit descends like a dove upon the Son as they begin their earthly ministry. We see all three members of the Trinity, not only there, but in other texts. We see it at the opening of his ministry. We see it at the close of his earthly ministry, just before his ascension, when he gives to his disciples there on the mountain the Great Commission and says to them, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations," baptizing them in the name that is singular in the Greek, but in the name singular of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So in the name of God. And who is God? God is Father, God is Son, God is Holy Spirit. Singular name, plurality of God. We have the same kind of thing that we see in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God, the Elohim. LB, God, Elohim, masculine, plural ending. You see God in creation. You see the Word in creation. We know the Word was with God. Word was God, from the very beginning, from before the beginning. And we have God, the Holy Spirit, moving upon the face of the waters. In the first couple of verses of Genesis, we have a picture given to us of the Blessed Trinity. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 4, Paul writes, "For indeed he was crucified because of weakness, yet he lives because of the power of God. For we also are weak in him, yet we shall live with him because of the power of God directed toward you." All right, what do you have? You have God, you have the Son, and you have the Spirit, which is the power of God directed toward you. As I said, the very first mention of God in the Bible, in verse 1 there, has to do with this marvelous, wonderful triunity of God. The very Hebrew word Elohim, the Hebrew word that we translate God in Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. It isn't until we get further into Genesis that we ever have another name, the first of the name Jehovah ever mentioned. It is in the ordinary sense, that word El, that word El, is the word for God or gods, lowercase, when it's uppercase, or when it's referring to God, it's formed differently. Though the word Trinity is never found in the pages of Scripture, it is a doctrine that is taught from the very first verse all the way through to the end of the book, from generations to resolutions, Genesis to Revelation, and everywhere in between. It's taught. Trinity is a word used to express the unity of God subsisting in three distinct persons. It is a word describing the unity of the Godhead as three co-equal, co-eternal persons, each having the same substance but distinct individuals. There is one God, and this one God manifests himself in the persons of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. To know one is to know them all. In fact, when speaking of Jesus, he said he is the exact representation of his very essence, his nature. Logically, our human minds can't entirely understand how one being can exist in three persons. Yet as Christians, we affirm both to be true. We do that certainly by faith, because it is a mystery, it is a truth that is so beyond our ability to even barely comprehend that it must be ascertained by faith, and only by faith. I believe that we'll understand it certainly more clearly when we're in his presence than we ever could possibly now. But it is a mystery, yet to be unveiled to us. Now, we know certain parts of it. A bit of struggle for you, not only myself, but everybody, to try and describe the Trinity. It's described oftentimes like, you know, I am a person, I'm me, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I'm a son, I'm a father, you know, we have all these ways, but that falls so terribly short. I've had people use the egg. There's the shell, the yolk, and the white, three in one. Well, that's nice, but it also falls short. I often use, in a way of trying to explain it, I use water, H2O. H2O can be a liquid, that's water. It could be a solid, that's ice, or it could be a vapor, that would be steam coming up. All three carry the same chemical properties. Water is water, H2O, whether it's in solid or liquid or vapor form. But even that falls far short of being unable to understand how God the Father was in heaven, God the Son was on earth, God the Holy Spirit was in the Son. But it's taught. We see it in creation. We see it when Paul writes the church of Colossae in the first chapter as he talks about creation. We see all the Father created, the Son created, the Spirit created. You know, we have this over and over and over in Scripture. In our statement of faith, that little thing we call the Baptist faith and message, I pulled out and I think I put it in here. Yeah, this is the beginning paragraph, if you will, of the Trinity. There is one and only one living and true God. He is an intelligent, spiritual, and personal being, the creator, redeemer, preserver, and ruler of the universe. God is infinite in his holiness and all other perfections. God is all-powerful and all-knowing, and his perfect knowledge extends to all things past, present, and future, including the future decisions of his free creatures. To him we owe the highest love, reverence, and obedience. The eternal triune God reveals himself to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with distinct personal attributes, but without division of nature, essence, or being. That's a concise statement. Doesn't explain to us how it all works. It just explains what the very essence or the basis or the ground or the foundation stone of our faith where God is concerned. The Trinity is one of the distinctive doctrines of Christianity. In fact, it has caused some to say that we are we have a plural faith. We are pluralistic in our faith. We are not monotheistic, but we are we believe in three gods, not one, and that's untrue. We believe that God is one, as Isaiah says, as God says of himself to Isaiah and in many other places. God is one, but we also know that that one is manifested in three distinct persons of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Just because it's hard for our brain to understand, it doesn't mean that we should pretend that it's not there. There is a lot of things in life, my friends, that our brain cannot completely get itself around, but it doesn't make it completely untrue. I don't know the inner workings and what causes a heart to beat and continue to beat until it doesn't beat anymore. I mean, just taking a natural progression of things. We're still trying to understand something like the brain and how it works. Now, we know a lot more than we used to, but we don't know it all, do we? And just because I can't see any of you that are out there, I would be foolish to say that none of you are out there, wouldn't I? Just because I can't see you. Matthew affirms the great Shema to us, which tells us how we are to love this wonderful, majestic, unexplainable, almighty God. In Matthew, in chapter 22, verse 37, he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind." And Luke says, "with all your strength." This is the greatest, the first commandment. Second is like unto this, love your neighbor as yourself. But this tells us how to love God with the entirety of our person. Christianity is intellectual, and we're expected to think through the teachings of Scripture. We're expected to be noble like those Bereans who didn't take Paul's word for it, but searched the Scriptures for themselves to see that it was true. And as we look to the Scriptures, we see four overriding truths about the Trinity. And I don't know that we'll get through all four of them this morning, but we'll probably get through a couple. First of all, number one, we see the divinity of the Trinity. This is the ultimate question behind the difficulty of accepting and understanding the Trinity. It is ultimately a question of the deity of Christ and the deity of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Bible is crystal clear that there is only one God, one divine being. Write this in your journals. If you can find it very quickly, you'll go to these verses, but write them down so at least you can go back and look at them again and check them out, cross-reference. Do diligence as you're studying, please. Don't just take my word for it. Be like those Bereans. Study the word for yourself. Get into the Scripture. Take that concordance. Use your cross-references. You don't have to have a huge, wonderful, big library of a lot of books or anything. You've got a good study Bible. It'll have a good concordance. Use it. Do those cross-references. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 39 says, "See now that I am He." There's that great I am statement of God. I am that I am. I am He, and there is no God beside me. It is I who put to death and give life. You see, out of Him is the very wellspring of life, and He can, I have wounded, and it is I who heal, and there is no one who can deliver from my hand. Now, in Isaiah 43 and verse 10, it said, you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, in order that I may know and you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, there was no God formed, and there will be none after me. But this same Bible, this same word, says that there is only one God, also says that the Father is God, and that the Son is God, and that the Holy Spirit is God. So these three persons must be the one true God. First of all, Scripture recognizes the Father as God, right? Put down, the Father is God. And right along with that, John 6:37, all that the Father gives me shall come to me, and the one who comes to me I will certainly not cast out. If you look at Paul's letters, he starts almost every one by saying greetings in the name of God the Father. So we know that the Father is God. But there's also a bunch of verses that teach us that Jesus is God. In the prophecy about the coming of the Messiah, Isaiah calls him mighty God, does he not? In that prophecy of his first advent, we look at it during this season all the time. Isaiah 9, verse 6, a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name shall be called what? Wonderful Counselor. Here you go. Mighty God, Eternal Father, and Prince of Peace. Now, does that not say very plainly and very clearly that the child that was to be born of us, that child that comes from the line of David, from the shoot of Jesse, that one who was born of a virgin mother, does it not say that he is mighty God and eternal Father? Well, he can't be Father in heaven and Father on earth. No. So the Son is God. Do you remember the story of doubting Thomas? Do you remember what he said when he saw and touched the risen Christ for that first time? In John 20 and verse 28, Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Jesus responded to Thomas, a good answer. Very cool, got it right. And Hebrews 1:8, but of the Son, he says, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever, and the righteous scepter is the scepter of his kingdom. Well, God, your Father is God, the Son is God, but the second thing you need to see, the Bible also teaches us that the Holy Spirit is God. You remember in Acts 5 when Ananias and Sapphira lied to the Holy Spirit about how much money they gave to the church? Remember what Peter told them? But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart that we'd lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back some of the price of the land? While it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, wasn't it under your control? Was it that you have conceived this deed? Why is it that you've conceived the deed in your heart? Then listen to this. You have not lied to men, but to who? Everybody? To God. Now, back up in verse 3, he says, Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit. Verse 4, he ends by saying, you've not lied to men, but to God. That makes then in Peter's mind, certainly, that the Holy Spirit is God. So lying to the Holy Spirit is the same thing as lying to God because he is God. Well, the second thing that we need to learn or we need to understand from Scripture concerning the Trinity is that, you see, the Trinity, you see the unity of the Trinity, especially in the creation of the world. Now, I don't know how far we'll get into this one. In fact, I'll probably just get into this verse in Genesis 1 and verse 26. It said, "Then God said, let us," see the plural, who's God talking to? Think he's talking to some angel out there or some salamander slithering on the ground? Or some amoeba, you know, swimming around in the primordial ooze? No. Let us make man in our own image. Certainly the image of God isn't that one-celled organism or that salamander coming out of the water that sparks the whole of evolution. Let us make man in our own image, according to our likeness. Let them rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky, over the cattle of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. Notice it doesn't say, let me make man. It says, let us make man. The triune God is involved in the creation of mankind. How do we know he's not referring to the angels? Because in Genesis 1:1, we have God creating the heavens and the earth. Verse 2, we have the Spirit of God hovering over the face of the water. Verse 3, we have the Word of God going forward in the act of creation. And I think I need to stop that here before we get further into this so that we have time to develop it more fully on Monday morning. All right? So are you with me? Are you with me so far? If you got those references written out, please go back and do your own due diligence. And we're going to pick up on this, what the Scripture says about the Trinity on Monday at 9 o'clock. By the way, weekend's full. On Monday, we launch Lottie Moon. And we begin, and we're going to launch that out with a week of prayer starting Sunday and ending that week of prayer on the 11th with the foreign mission study or the international mission study at 9:45 in Sunday school. Next week, we're going to be having I'm going to insert at the very beginning. I love to do this for all of our folks, whether they're, you know, wherever they are, in Korea or Atlanta, it doesn't matter, or any of the 48 states or other countries in the world that are picking up on our teaching. I like to take during the week of prayer and do something significant to keep our focus and our thoughts on this special event. So we're going to be having a few of those, you know, in the beginning and then back into the study. So next week's going to be a lot of fun, I think. It's going to just be a lot of fun. And we're going to pick up all the Trinity on Monday morning at 9 o'clock. Come down. Be with us Sunday morning. Let's have a great time in worship together. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you so much for just the thrill of your word, to be able and to get in and to study and to look and to absorb and to drink in, to feast upon the meal that you set before us in your word. Father, enrich our very lives because, Lord, we're spending it with you. Open our minds and our understanding. Drive us, Lord, to your word to study to see that these things are true. Study for ourselves. To you be praise and glory, Lord. Let us constantly be faithful to your word, so that if you come back, yes, Lord, you will find faith upon the earth when you come. We love you. Oh, God, we thank you for the time. Now, bless these that are here today. Pour blessing upon them. Use them in magnificent ways, Lord. Your will to be done. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' blessed name, we pray. Amen. and amen. God bless you. Listen, you all have a spectacular weekend. We'll see you on Sunday. Come on down. I'll be sending out an email tomorrow that has the listening guide for Sunday and a prayer guide for you that will pick it up online and some other things. So join together. Come together. Let's worship together. May God bless you. We'll see you later. And Monday, 9 o'clock.